Well, they may be partying in the soccer world tonight, but there's little to celebrate in a range of other sporting codes. Scandals are engulfing the AFL, the NRL and even swimming. St Kilda player Stephen Milne has been formally charged with four counts of rape dating back 9 years. On the same day, NRL players George Burgess and Blake Ferguson have found themselves on the wrong side of the law. And retired swimmer Scott Miller has also been charged with possessing drugs and stolen property. Sarah Arbo reports.
The alleged crime dates back 9 years, but the accusations against Stephen Milne are now back in the spotlight. In 2004, the St Kilda footballer was involved in an alleged sexual assault following a club family day. The incident was investigated, but until now, no charges were laid, and Milne has always maintained his innocence. At club training, Milne kept a low profile, leaving his teammate Nick Riewoldt to reflect the club's position.
Look, obviously can't say too much at the moment. It's an ongoing issue and a police issue now, so there's not really much as a player that we can say.
In a statement, the AFL Players Association says it will support Milne throughout the court process. He's due to face the Melbourne Magistrates Court on July 5th. The NRL isn't exactly squeaky clean either. Rabbitohs star George Burgess has been charged after allegedly smashing a street sign through a car window in Cairns early yesterday. While he wasn't at training today, he released a statement apologising to fans, admitting he'd let his team and family down. The NRL was quick to act, suspending Burgess for 2 games. He was also fined $10,000 and ordered to undertake anger management classes. The Canberra Raiders also have a misbehaving player in their ranks. And now Blake Ferguson's alleged assault in Cronulla may cost him his career. The player accused of groping a young woman in a bar.
Some decisions he makes, you know, when on the grog and also being with the people, you know, he doesn't have a tendency to mix with the right people.
Following repeated behavioural issues, Ferguson has been stood down for State of Origin 2 and there's mounting pressure on his club to sack him. A witness to Sunday night's incident, teammate Josh Dugan, though, remains in camp.
Hey, can you tell us what happened the other night?
Well publicised.
And late today, New South Wales police charged former Olympic swimmer Scott Miller after he was allegedly found with drugs and stolen goods. With a series of misdemeanours among elite athletes, the very culture of Australian sport is now being called into question.
Sarah Arbo with that report. Now let's get some more on this story. Garie Dooley is from Leading Teams. It's an organisation that works with various Australian sporting codes to set up leadership development and culture change. Garie Dooley, thanks for your time tonight. Just looking at the sort of charge sheet from the last week or so, we've got allegations of drink driving, indecent assault, willful damage, 4 counts of rape, possession of drugs and suspected stolen goods across AFL, NRL and swimming. It doesn't sound very good.
It's quite a challenging environment, isn't it, Hamish? It sort of begs the question, what's happening inside of those environments that suggests that those choices of behaviour are acceptable? So it does present a bit of a quandary.
Do you think there are some teams, though, that are deliberately taking on players who might be considered to be high risk because they see the same characteristics that might produce perhaps dangerous or illegal behaviour as being the same sorts of characteristics that could, in some moments, bring about brilliance on the field?
I think there's a shift towards if the person, male, female, swimmer, cricketer, soccer player, whatever, if they can deliver the skill, we might allow some shifts in behaviour. I think there's definitely some organisations who live by that.
So clubs actually need to change the way they are selecting players or buying players, as it were.
I think essentially there needs to be a shift in understanding that behaviour drives performance. I think we're seeing some organisations miss that bit. They miss the fact that, yes, you can have some highly skilled individuals, but if their behaviour doesn't match that and their behaviour doesn't drive them towards elite performance consistently, then they will run the risk of this sort of thing coming up again and again and again.
So is the solution, do you think, just about cultural shift within the clubs, or is it also about that being matched by more severe or stiffer penalties from the codes for individuals who misbehave?
I think that there certainly has to be a consequence. But I think, you know, unfortunately, the consequence comes at the end of a almost an habitual set of behaviours. And I think we need to move away from the individual. Now, what is happening in that environment that suggests those choices are okay? The consequence, unfortunately, has to be administered by, in today's case or yesterday's case, the NRL. You'd like to think at some point their teammates are saying, you know what, that behaviour's not acceptable, mate. But we don't see that happening in some environments. It's just left to the body to sanction them.
If you were going to go into a club or even into a code, let's use NRL for example, yeah, how long do you reckon it would take to turn this culture around? Give us a time span.
Depends, I mean, without avoiding it, depends on the appetite of the organisation. Also depends on the appetite of the senior coach around, you know, how willing are they prepared.
Let's assume they're fully signed up to it. They say they are.
Yep.
How long would it take you to institute that sort of cultural shift?
I think you'll see a shift in performance pretty quickly. It's about how resolute they are about reviewing and how determined they are to actually maintain that standard around the behavioural framework. A classic example for me is the Sydney Swans. What they are absolutely resolute about is reviewing. They recruit against what they stand for. They will acknowledge, you know, young players' skills, but they'll also make an effort to ensure they're better people as a result of the experience, not just better athletes. So you'll see a quick change, but to be honest, Hamish, you're probably looking at 12 months to 18 months before you see it become embedded in the way they go about their business.
Garie Dooley, thank you for talking to us tonight.
Pleasure. Thanks, Hamish.